something, you are truly devoted to something that you forget about the world around you. That is what is meditation, actually, in actual terms. The main person who really introduced me to spirituality, to meditation, and to this kind of life was someone called Master Zigong Sha, Doctor and Master Zigong Sha.
Okay.
And he's this world-renowned acupuncturist. It opens your mind towards things that you didn't even know of.
Welcome everyone. So today we are with us Ms. Hitika Mirk. She is the founder of Heart Over Heels. Let's talk about her journey and spirituality, how she started meditating and how changed cause of it. She shares her journey from an impulsive teenager to a soul healer and a transformative coach. She shares what she does to be centered during this pandemic, and she believes we don't use meditation to avoid in a social challenge, but we use it to deepen the capacity to meet a social challenge directly.
So, hello everyone. Let's welcome Hitika Mirk. Hello, hi ma'am, how are you?
I'm amazing, Hardik, how are you?
Yeah, I'm also good. So, wanted to ask that how are you dealing with this lockdown?
I think everyone is dealing with this lockdown differently. But when it just comes to spirit, especially me, I think what I am doing is I am meditating on a regular basis. And I'm just trying my level best to be happy, to keep a positive outlook towards everything that is happening, because every day that we see the news, something else, it's like a bomb that is just there, you know, on us on an everyday basis. So it's difficult in such times to be happy, but I think I find happiness in the most smallest moments, and that is what actually keeps me going. So
okay.
That is how I'm dealing with my lockdown.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, it's same situation for all of us, all our lockdown and all.
Yeah. How are you dealing with your lockdown?
Yeah, I'm just reading some books, and I am a startup enthusiast, so like just brainstorming, working on some ideas.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Great.
So tell us how you started your journey with Heart Over Heels.
Interesting. It all started when I first came into spirituality. And that was back in 2014,
okay.
December. And back then, I think I was just 17 or 18. I was 17 or 18. And from that point, it was like every situation in my life was coming to a standstill for me. I didn't know what to do with my career. Like, it was a normal teenage problem for me. That I was confused about the career, I was confused with all the things that was happening in my family, with my friends and all of that. But it was more like an external or an internal battle that I was dealing with. And that actually drove me towards spirituality, and I just started serving. And when I started serving, I went to different schools and I started teaching about love, and I started teaching about peace and harmony and how to exactly embody love, peace and harmony in our daily life to junior KG students, to senior KG students. And I started spending more time with them, and I realized that all these children in our society at the moment are actually struggling with self-love. And you could see it even in the junior KG students. You could see that thing was starting, the self-love issue was starting to develop. And I just happened to get this opportunity to go and teach a senior KG or a junior KG student. And I started teaching them about meditations, and I started talking to them about love. And because just some of these conversations don't really take place in a family, right? People don't really talk about love, or they don't talk about peace in a family.
Yeah.
So that's how I think my journey started. And slowly I just decided that I need a name for what I do. And I think one day I just came up with a name, you know what, that my thing will be called as Heart Over Heels. because I was going to do an event with Mitti Ke Rang, and so I think it was just a more formal name given to it, something that I was actually doing since 2014. So that was heart over heels.
Okay, so like, did you go with the flow, or you were just got the right vibes that I should do this thing? So how you, like, what was that?
It was definitely not that.
Okay.
So it was definitely not that. It was, so I think every individual, when it comes to spirituality, they first actually go through the most hardest choice, you know. As they say, when all the doors start closing on to you, you just know that, you know, one door is opening and you just grab that opportunity. So I think that is what exactly I did. I really felt in my life that all the doors that were in my life, you know, all the people, they were turning their backs, and I was just falling in each and every aspect of my life. And I thought, okay, spirituality is something that will help me. And it was just a random intuitive thought that I got. Spirituality is going to help me out. And then I started, and it was a long journey. Let me tell you, it was not the easy one. It is never an easy one with spirituality, never.
Okay.
But it just felt right somewhere. Like, I just knew it in my heart that it's going to help me out. It's going to save me from losing a battle.
It's kind of gut feeling or something. Like, this thing is right and
yeah,
I should
a
go
gut
with
feeling
it.
And intuition.
Yeah, definitely. So, like, how you practice this meditation, spirituality? Is there a proper way of doing it, or like, who can do it? How we can practice this in our daily life?
I think everyone can do a meditation. Everyone. There are countless ways to do a meditation. People think meditation is just closing your eyes and just sitting somewhere, you know.
Yeah.
That is not meditation, let me tell you. Meditation is actually something that you truly enjoy, something you are truly devoted to, something that you forget about the world around you. That is what is meditation, actually, in actual terms. And anybody can do a meditation. The most effective way of realizing what truly gives you happiness is the closing your eyes way. Unfortunately, that is the way wherein you have to just close your eyes and just sit and just visualize something. So that is what I do. What I do is I close my eyes, I sit, and I first start focusing on my breath, because breath is so important. Everyone breathes, right? So
yeah.
With that, it's the same way meditation can be done by everyone, right?
Yeah.
And we ignore our breath. Our breath so much that we take our breath for granted. But when we fall ill, when we have fever and our nose is blocked, that time we actually realize that, you know, oh my God, the nose is so important because I'm not able to breathe, right?
Yeah.
That time we realize it. So that is how what I do. I focus on my breath, and slowly I just start visualizing something or the other that I truly want to. And then I just go with the flow, whatever my body takes me, wherever my body takes me, wherever my mind takes me. So I don't usually be strict on my mind. You know how people say, meditation is about stopping your thoughts, stopping your mind thoughts. It's a mind. We can't only stop our thoughts, right? That is not possible. But it's important to just know that you can just observe our thoughts and not react to it. That is what is important. If you just observe them and then just don't react to them. It's okay. Just let it be. And as soon as you start doing that, those thoughts are going to go away and you will end up being more peaceful. So that's what I do.
So, like, it's just like analyzing our thoughts and without reacting over it. Yeah, kind of.
Exactly. So, when you just say analyze is followed by a reaction.
Yeah.
So, no. It's
okay.
Just observing.
Okay.
Just plain
observing. Okay. Observing. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
So like, what are the effects of, like, meditation? If a person practices it on daily basis, or like on regular intervals, what changes it brings in a person's, like, behavior, mind?
So I would tell you my story here again.
Yeah.
So something that really affected me because of meditation was, I was just very energetic, very enthusiastic, bubbly, and a wild child, you know. I would say I was a very wild child. So I would just do anything and everything that I want, and I used to never really care about what the reaction or what the circumstances or what the situation is going to be created because of that. Mm-hmm. I never really did that. And I was a moment person and everything. And that actually ended up with me hurting so many people around me, hurting myself, creating such situations that would have easily been avoided. Mm-hmm. So I would say meditation really helped me to calm me down. It made me more centered in life, something that was needed. And imagine if you see a 24-year-old running around doing whatever the hell she wants to and just spoiling everything. You wouldn't like that, right? Yeah. Nobody would like that.
Yeah.
So it just helped me become more calmer, centered. And on a regular basis, if someone does meditation, they become more centered in life. It's easier to make decisions because this is, you know, those decisions just come naturally to you. It boosts your immune system. That is something which is so required at the moment, because with what is going on at the, you know, in our world at the moment, it helps you to boost your immunity, your energy, and it helps you to actually focus in life on something that you really want. It doesn't really allow you to distract yourself as easily as you used to. And meditation just helps you to become more peaceful, more loving towards yourself first and then towards others.
Okay.
So I think that is a beautiful journey.
So like if we want to sum up, like it it teaches us to focus on things. It makes us more stable in life and stable in our thoughts. It gives us a way towards a peaceful mind. And it also and it also boosts our immune system. So it's really good for every individual. So everyone should practice it. Yeah.
Definitely. Everyone should practice it.
So like as you told about meditation, so like is meditation and spirituality both different things, or like because both the words are used in different way at different places?
So see, at times an individual would follow meditation but not really go into the depths of it.
Okay.
So that for that individual, meditation would be just, you know, sitting with a quiet mind, just closing your eyes and just sitting for 2-3 minutes in the morning and then just continuing what they do on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So meditation, I would say, is a start of spirituality. Mm-hmm. It's not completely spirituality. But again, it's just a step towards spirituality, because there are so many things when we say spirituality, and that actually comes to meditation. That actually comes to mindfulness, because now mindfulness is a word that is being thrown a lot, you know, here and there.
Every year,
you should be mindful towards your approach. You should be conscious towards your approach. So meditation actually teaches you to consciously live your life, consciously live in each and every aspect of your life. So I would say they go hand in hand, but then again, it depends on the person how different they want meditation and spirituality to be like, or how together they want it to be like.
Okay. Like then who is your spiritual guru, or whom do you follow in your life?
So I actually follow many people in my life. Okay. So I go for here and there for small things, but the main person who really introduced me to spirituality, to meditation, and to this kind of life was someone called Master Zigong Sha, Dr. and Master Zigong Sha.
Okay.
And he's this world-renowned acupuncturist. He was this world-renowned acupuncturist, and he's from China, actually. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, he's in Canada. So then he just decided that, you know, he wants to dedicate his entire life towards service, and he wants to help people out. And he was, from a very young age, he was inclined towards spirituality and towards many, many different healing modalities. And then once he just decided that he has to do this because of the intuitions he got and the dreams that he saw, and he just got this mission up for soul healing, and that is what I do. I'm a soul healer.
Okay. Nowadays, this trend is coming in, like you, that they are also like trying to do meditation and spirituality. Like, do you follow any like influencers or something who are into spiritual thing?
I would say at the moment, law of attraction is something that is in trend, and that is always going to be in trend because law of attraction is something which has an amazing PR, you know, always there and everything. Law of attraction. So I follow a bunch of people. Someone called Manifestation Babe on Instagram, and How to Manifest Again on Instagram. But okay. Mainly for spirituality, I follow Soul Healing, Brigham Shah, and Tony Robbins. So I'm a huge fan of Tony Robbins.
Yeah, I know about and, that. I've heard about
it. Yeah, so yeah. He talks a lot about gratitude.
Yeah, gratitude.
He talks a lot about gratitude, and I think gratitude is the way to live, actually, whatever you want. It will just multiply if you're just grateful for what you have at the moment.
Okay. So what changes takes place in a person's psychology when he tries spirituality and meditation?
I think it just widens your horizons, you know.
Okay.
One's horizon, because it opens your mind towards things that you didn't even know of.
Okay.
Like you didn't even know that you don't know something like that. That is what it actually widens your horizons, and it actually depends on your childhood as well, I would say. It makes you question each and everything that you have been through, each and everything you have learned in your life. That is what meditation and spirituality does, and it just helps you to become more more self-independent, more self-loving, self-compassionate. And all of these things which are so important, which it just helps you to become independent, you know. And you don't really rely on the beliefs that you were taught or the society per se. And I think that is how it changes your personality overall. It changes your psychology overall. That is how it does.
Okay. And recently I saw a video on your Instagram. Like you were talking about some detox thing. So, like, what is detox? How it's done? Like, who can do it? And share your experience for it, for the same.
Okay, great. So, yeah, talk to me, okay? Detox, everyone can do a detox. When people hear a word called detox, first they just think about a food detox or, you know, just some cleansing diet. But detox is actually a cleanse. That is what it is. And I decided to go in this detox because, and what I did was in that detox was I just threw away my phone. I was away from my phone for 3 days. I was away from my family members as well because it was just becoming so much for me. I was really overwhelmed with what was going on around me. It was with the news, it was with the media, it was the way everyone was reacting in my house. It was all the reactions that were coming to me, and because of which I was just totally overwhelmed. And I decided to do this was I locked myself in a room, and I had this wonderful experience wherein I realized that I had so many beliefs that doesn't really work for me anymore. So many beliefs I had learned in my childhood that wasn't really working for me anymore. I also realized that I was surrounded by some of the toxic relations in my life, which really helped me to focus on that and realize that how much I was deploying myself and not really concentrating on myself, and because of which I realized that I had major self-love issues as well. Self-worth issues, self-love issues, you name it, and I had it, you know. That was the thing. And in just 3 days, imagine, just in 3 days, I realized so many things, and I decided that, you know what, that's it, enough is enough, and I want to transform this. And I think I just started taking these small steps here and there. I started going towards the mirror and talking to myself, like saying, I am wonderful, I'm amazing, and I'm really worth each and every desire that I have. And I never really did that. Like, trust me, I never did that. And I never really thought that I was worth having something in my life. So I had major self-worth issues, because of which I used to just accept if someone used to behave badly with me and everything. I used to just accept that, okay, you know what, I need that person in my life, that person is important. It's okay the way that person treats me, that's fine, that's okay. And then I realized that isn't really fine. It starts with me. So I started being more compassionate towards me. And that's when the self-love journey started. And I realized that I'm really worth it, you know. Screw everyone that everything said. I'm really worth it. I really am worth about for all the desires that I have. I deserve to be happy. I deserve to be loving. I deserve to surround myself with the people who really love me. Mm-hmm. And that is what the detox did for me. It's like it changed my life in a whole 360 degree way. You know, that is what it did. So I think a detox, anybody can do this detox. And the main reason why I did that was because I was feeling overwhelmed and my emotions were running here and there. And I was reacting to situations that didn't really need a reaction. Mm-hmm. It was just as simple as that. And it also made me realize that the fears that I had, the fears and the beliefs that I had was actually not my own. You know, these fears, each and every fear that a person has is actually from the childhood.
Yeah.
You know, that we keep hearing from our parents, from our grandparents, something that we always keep hearing. Say, for example, money. If someone in your childhood would have ever said to the other person that, you know what, I can't really afford this at the moment, bang on, there is a money belief that came in. And you know what? Money doesn't grow on trees. I need to save money. I need to do this. I need to do that. And that is when the fear of money starts. You know, because this is something that we hear our entire life, that money doesn't grow on trees, for example. And then we carry this fear that, you know what, I need to save money. And the more we save, we have this belief that I'm going to save. You know how they say, if I was going to close their wrist like that, the sandwich is going to go from the space that is there. It's the same way. If you're going to keep anything like that, mm-hmm. that thing is going to go away from the space that is there in between our fingers.
No.
So I realized that I had these fears that were not mine. Mm-hmm. So, and then I decided that, you know what, enough. I'm going to transform these fears as well. So it was so easy for me to do that as well again.
Okay.
Just because of this talk.
Okay. So like if you want to sum up with 3 points, like what detox gave you, like personally you, because you have tried it on you. So like what are the 3 points if you will sum up the detox thing?
Okay. The detox taught me that I am capable of love, mm-hmm. my own love, that too. The talk taught me that all the beliefs and the fears that I have, I can easily unlearn them and I can learn the new ones. It's very easy to do that. And the talk also taught me about the toxic relationship. These are the 3 things. Okay. And I'm sorry, I'm going to include the fourth one also there. I'm so sorry.
The fourth one
and the most important one was, that even though, you know, I was on the social media, I follow all these accounts that really inspire me and mm-hmm. keep me positive and everything like that. But I still had those negative reactions. I still had those outbursts, mm-hmm. you know. And it taught me that it was so easy for me to go on Netflix and just watch some shows. Mm-hmm. Just switch on the TV and watch something. Or just take my mind from one thing to the other. It was so easy for me to do that. And when I was doing that, I was really ignoring my emotions. I was not integrating what I was really learning. If I was taking some course online, I wasn't really integrating that whatever that I was learning, that course in my life. And that is what the detox taught me the most, that I need to integrate what I was learning. And I can't really ignore my emotions. Even if I was just concentrating on the positive ones, but I need to feel all of my emotions in order for me to deal with them and have a balanced life.
Okay. Okay, then it was really, really a fascinating thing. Like I never heard about this. Like I heard, but never knew what exactly it is and what exactly it does to us. So like
it's easy to do and I think it's the most rewarding experience.
Okay. So like nowadays, like, we have a concentrating issues in like young generation. Like if I take example of mine, like I'm not able to concentrate on one thing for a long time. But if we do meditation and spirituality, the same thing, the main thing is concentration. So like how you can connect both and deal with it?
I think the first most important thing is to start very at the very bottom, you know, when it comes to, if you have this fear of, you know, I can't really concentrate, so I can't really close my eyes and just sit. I won't be able to concentrate. I won't be able to get there where I want to.
Yeah.
So I'll just share this one exercise that I do, which is mm-hmm. so simple. It helps me again to center myself, and then when I'm centered, it's all about being centered. It's all about keeping our mind in our heart, you know, just listening to our heart, just listening to our breath.
Yeah.
It's all that comes down to it. So this stretch is one exercise that I do for my concentration that helps me to become more grounded in life. And then it's very easy for me to meditate, or it's very easy for me to give 100% focus to something that I really want to. So what I do is I go with my senses.
Okay.
And for that, I concentrate on the first five things that I can see, you know, the first five things I can see. And then I increase. So this is something called is the 5-4-3-2-1 method. This is what it is called.
Okay.
So the first thing that I do is, what are the five things I can see? And I'll just look around here and there what I can see, the five things. And then the second one is, what are the four things I can touch?
Okay.
You know, around me, what are the four things that I can touch? Is it my phone? Is it my hair? Is it my specs? Is it whatever? Then I think about, what are the three things that I can hear?
Mm-hmm.
Now for this, you need to close your eyes and you just need to listen. You know, again, you need to focus, right? You need to listen to what are the three things you can hear. Then I concentrate on, what are the two things I can smell?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm using my nose here.
Yeah.
You know, what are the two things I can smell? And the last thing is, what is that one thing that I can taste?
Mm-hmm.
Anything that I can taste.
Yeah.
So this really helps me become more grounded. This helps me to get the concentration back, because I'm focusing on everything around me.
Mm-hmm.
So that is, I use the body. I use my body. I use my five senses. And I get the concentration back. So this is the most effective way, the most easiest way. I think in just 5 minutes you're back on. Mm-hmm. I think this is the most easiest way to do it.
So like, is there any name for this 5-4-3-2-1 concept? I really liked it.
This is the name. This is the name. The 5-4-3-2-1 method.
Okay. I will surely try it and will let you know.
Sure. You can try it right now with me if you want.
No, I will try it like alone, afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah, so like, it was really great to talk with you. You shared your experience. You told us about this new concept. You shared some tips with us for spirituality and meditation. So like, it was really great to have you here on MKR. Thank you, ma'am.
It was really great to be invited here, so thank you. And I hope you're enjoying your time at MKR, because MKR is such a loving, loving, loving organization, really close to my heart.
Yeah.
So I wish you guys all the love, and thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yeah.